to our seminar in Ukrainian studies, which I'm happy to say is again on literature. Not just literature, but poetry, which means this is where the action is. And indeed, it is going to be about where the action is. Our speaker today is Professor Polina Barskova, who is Associate Professor of Russian Literature at Hampshire College. She was born in Leningrad and left what was then Petersburg for Berkeley in 1998 and got her MA and PhD there. Her scholarly publications include articles on Nabokov, the Bakhtin brothers, early Soviet film, and the aesthetization of historical trauma, and especially the siege of Leningrad, 1941 to 44, which eventuated in this wonderful book called Written in the Dark, where five poets in the siege of Leningrad are presented in both the original and in very fine translations into English. And this is edited by Professor Barskova. She has been, she has published a number of books of poetry and a book of prose in Russian, and three books of her poetry in English translation were published recently. And most recently, she has turned her attention also to Ukrainian poetry. She has been working on translation and interpretation projects treating this poetry and published her translations of Zhadan, Yakymchuk, who spoke here, as you remember, a year ago, and Kiyanovska. She also authored the afterword to the recent anthology of Ukrainian war poetry, Words for War, which appeared just very recently, and in fact was presented at the ETSU conference in Chicago in November of last year. This subject is also, this is also the subject of her ongoing research at Uri. Her talk today is called Ukrainian Poetry in a Time of Crisis, and what could be more a crisis than the ongoing war that we have now been experiencing, let's say Ukrainian people have been experiencing since 2014. And this is the crucible in which great poetry is made. So without further ado, I will let you speak.
First of all, I would like to thank everybody who is here on this perfectly cold day. I would like to thank Yuri for this opportunity, for this time to think, to research, to write. Title of the specific angle, specific paper that I would like to present today is The Rules of Decomposition, Traumatic Language in Ukrainian Post-Maidan Poetry. It would be a disservice to the time frame of this presentation to delve in depth into history of war representation in modernist art and literature. So I would limit myself to just to examples, just to images. The first one on our handouts belongs to the Finnish and Swedish writer and cartoonist Tove Jansson. Actually, it's one of my favorite images ever. I grew up with it. Little did I know that actually Tove was inspired to start her Mumintrollen series by her experience during the Soviet-Finnish war campaign of 1939, which she spent in complete darkness in Helsinki, darkness due to the blackout. This experience of deprivation and helplessness invoked in her creation of the world of magic creatures, Mumintrollen, the others, who needed to invent their own terms and, importantly, their own language in order to comprehend this crisis of sudden winter that endangered their whole world. The second image is, of course, a cover to a poem, Battle of Adrianople, that Filippo Tommaso Marinetti was publishing from 1912 to 1914. And the recent blurb on the latest reproduction of this text reads, "Now we see it as a seminal work of modernist art." Marinetti witnessed this battle as a war reporter, and in his text of sound poetry, he proceeded to invent a new way to represent the unrepresentable, as he wrote himself, "terror and agitation of the massacre." These two approaches, to encode the terror into the images of surreal comfort and intimacy by othering it, or to challenge the very laws of discourse, are integral to our conversation today. My research project explores an urgent and exciting phenomenon, the developments in Ukrainian poetry in the years after the upheaval of the 2014 Euromaidan and during the Russo-Ukrainian hybrid war in Donbas. I argue that it is within the realm of poetical expression that the Ukrainian literary identity is being shaped today, primarily. Following the idea by the Russian formalist Yuri Tynianov, and he won't be the only formalist who will visit us today, about the significance of smaller literary forms for the dialogue between the aesthetic and the political discourses, I suggest to look at the field of contemporary Ukrainian poetry as a rhetorical laboratory where new forms of political expression are being worked out. My own scholarly position vis-à-vis this phenomenon requires some explanation. My previous and ongoing project is dedicated to the language of poetry from the siege. It was through my analysis of this poetry, poetry of trauma and suffering, that I became aware of the magnitude and urgency of literary response to the Maidan events and its aftermath. I want to stress several things about my notes today that I see as raw. First of all, the subject matter. But also, I need to point out that my research at this point is at its beginning stages. My Ukrainian is that of a reader, not of a speaker, and that explains that I will read poetry in English translation, though on your handouts you have it in original. Among things that I absolutely understand that I need to do more and more is to read the actual poetry, though, as Professor Grabowicz just pointed out, I am endlessly excited about existence of this volume, Words for War, with its 16 authors, though actually, Alekh just brought more of these handsome volumes. Those 16 authors only begins to cover the map of this poetry. I think some of the most important voices are represented. The work of translation was a powerful trigger for my thinking about these matters. Simultaneously with translating Jadan and Kiyanovska and Yakymchuk, we've been working on a forum that recently was published in Poetry International, and you have the link on your handout. The idea of this forum was to interview Ukrainian, Russian, Belarusian, Polish, and Lithuanian poets and ask them the following questions. How did the war influence your life and, crucially, your literary work? Can poetry oppose propaganda? And can poetry help in the creation of language in which we, the society or societies, speak about this war today? As a part of my Huri work, I have decided to deepen this interviewing process by building the next interconnected cycle of interviews, not on poets' ideas, but rather on their specific poetic texts about the war. And it's been one of the most exciting things of my last 2 months. Poets are often discussed. Poets are rarely asked about their work. And sometimes these are the most difficult and interesting conversations imaginable. So some of the answers are a part of this discussion today. Let's start. The main poetic stylistic phenomenon that I'll be analyzing today was described in the early 1940s by somebody who knew the map of this campus rather well, by Roman Jakobson, who suggested that traumatic experience might cause human language to be damaged. And he uses, of course, a Greek term for this, being aphasia. Understood as a process of regression and disintegration of the individual speech. Among various kinds of aphasia, Jakobson singles out contiguity disorder. He writes, "In the contiguity disorder, sentences lose their variety. They are diminished. Word order becomes chaotic. The ties of grammatical coordination and subordination are dissolved. Aphatics lose the ability to combine linguistic elements. Their grammar fails them, and they can express only heaps of words. The order of the words becomes chaotic, and words with purely grammatical functions tend to drop out of the picture altogether. These aphatics thus tend to sound infantile and can manage only very short sentences. Very strange language emerges." In order to take this notion that I find useful out of the realm of clinical into the realm of symbolic, anthropologist Sergei Ushakin, in his research of post-Soviet subjectivity, registers regression of language that would help its users to express their complex emotions. It is precisely this language of regression, of damage, that I see in several outstanding poetical practices of the Ukrainian war poetry today, used, however, as an intentional device. In order to write trauma, poets invent post-traumatic languages of their own. My series of close readings that will start now focus on various attempts to reconstruct aphasia by means of poetry by Lyubov Yakymchuk, Marianna Kiyanovska, and Alex Averbukh. My research questions are, what are the various strategies used by these poets to reproduce traumatic language? How these different strategies allude to the larger semantic frameworks that these different poetries imply? So, since there are some people who just arrived, thank you so much. I think I'm the last person in this classroom who doesn't dare to use the more contemporary ways to disseminate information. So let us start with a poem by Lyubov Yakymchuk, perhaps the most emblematic text of this whole phenomenon. Maybe sometimes I think we can call it an emblem for the overall poetic momentum and its linguistic tendencies. The poem «Раскладание», «Decomposition». Lyubov Yakymchuk, Ukrainian poet, screenwriter, journalist, was born in Pervomaisk. In her book «Абрикосы Донбасу», «Apricots of Donbas», 2015, she describes experience of her family that had to flee its familial habitat, risking their lives. In Yakymchuk's own words, interview, "I was born and raised in the war-torn Luhansk region, and my hometown of Pervomaysk is now occupied. In May 2014, I witnessed the beginning of the war. In February 2015, my parents and grandmother, having survived dreadful warfare, set out to leave the occupied territory. They left under shelling fire with a few bags of clothes. So now I'll read English, you can read Ukrainian. Розкладання, decomposition. Nothing changes on the Eastern Front. Well, I've had it up to here. At the moment of death, metal gets hot and people get cold. Don't talk to me about Luhansk. It's long since turned into Hansk. Lu has been raised to the ground, to the crimson pavement. My friends are hostages, and I cannot reach them. I can't do Netsk to pull them out of their basements from under the rubble. Yet here you are writing poems, ideally slick poems, high-minded gilded poems, beautiful as embroidery. There is no poetry about war, just decomposition. Only letters remain, and they all make a single sound. Rrr. Pervomaysk has been split into Pervo and Maysk, into particles in primeval flux. War is over once again, yet peace has not come. And where is my dear als Evo? No poet will be born there again, no human being. I stare into the horizon. It has narrowed into a triangle. Sunflowers dip their heads in the field, black and dried out, like me. I have gotten so very old, no longer Luba, just a ba. It's interesting to observe difference, as usual, between the original and the translation. The poet depicts the traumatic event as causing challenge to the traditional form and laws of human language. She represents the impact of bombing on its victim through morphological fragmentation and decay. What exactly is being damaged here? Principally, and in a way most unbearably, it is the main semantic link of any linguistic structure, that of the signified and the signifier. In peril, Yakymchuk writes about the city and the body being destroyed, and their names becoming incoherent. The word is being damaged together with the body of it. Simultaneously with the impotence and vulnerability of the word, Yakymchuk registers and challenges power of the word, especially that dangerous power to misrepresent history by glossing over its traumas. Here you are, writing poems, ideally slick poems. The last onomatopoetic semblance, r, that brings us back to Marinetti, an attempt to reproduce sound of a bullet or a shell, sends Yakymchuk to her relationship with futurism. It kind of helps to know whom your poets studied at the universities. Yakymchuk wrote on Semenko. When I ask her who are the most important influences from her point of view and why, this is the answer she gave me. I drive my inspiration mostly from Semenko and his sound, and my another teacher of sound is Tichina, and how he floods his verse with the sounds of pain. Another poet who writes a lot about his relationship with the Ukrainian poetry of the 1920s is somebody whose wonderful spirit is with us today, but not in these notes, is of course Jadan, whose university research was on the poetic forms of Ukrainian revolution of the 1920s. And for him, the most important figure, again, according to him, were Sasura, Holivoy, and Druzhnik. And this is the area of this research that I find to be maybe centrally interesting, how tradition is being used, abused, and renewed in these texts. In the last stanza of her text, Yakymchuk writes how the process of war witnessing destroys the witness. The one who produces the text of witness becomes disfigured. She herself, Luba, now only Ba, becomes a mirror of history that she describes. So speaking of witnessing, the next poet who uses devices of decomposition strongly, poignantly, and controversially is Marianna Kiyanovska. And since I've spent last months, as we all do, surrounded with our volumes of reading, and so the classical text about Ukrainian futurism is dedicated to the notion of scandal, and appropriately so. Speaking of scandals, I think that the most beautiful scandal of the recent Ukrainian poetry is this book by Kiyanovska called Babin Yar Golosami. Babin Yar, through the voices, for the voices, by the voices. It's an interesting question, which preposition in the voices, right? There was lots of interesting, difficult critique dedicated to this book. Also, it just received a very prestigious Shalom Aleichem Prize. There are all kinds of questions being addressed to the author. The author. Kiyanovska comes from Zhovkva near Lviv, a writer and a translator. And it is very important in this case that she works so much in translation. She herself translates mostly from Belarusian and Polish, author of 9 books of poetry. This, before I go into a description of this book, I want to mention, and I think it's useful, even if marginally, to have these ghost guests in this room, that recently very interesting conversation emerged online between 2 poets, Ukrainian poets, who are very interested in discussion in their poetry of the Ukrainian-Jewish relationship in the 20th century. This is conversation between Kiyanovska and Khersonsky. So this book takes us to the Nazi-occupied Kiev of 1941. There is an interesting question among many controversies touched by this book. There is a question of when. Which moment she describes. Is it the moment in September of 1941, or is it the whole period of 2 years during which Babin Yar was used as a central massacre place in Kyiv? Because, as we remember, over these 2 years of Nazi occupation, the Ravine continually was used as a place of execution of political dissidents, prisoners of war, psychiatric patients, and various undesirables of all ethnicities. And so we are speaking of roughly 120,000. As with every case of our discussion, the main inquiry of this book is that of witness. Whose voice about Babi Yar massacre can we hear today? Do we want to hear today? Whose voice can we trust? Kiyanovska writes the event of Babi Yar from different points of view, combining voices of those who perished, those who witnessed and survived, and those who are problematically are trying to find a way to speak about it today. And actually, this is where I think the heart of the problem and the real controversy, and I think Kiyanovska breakthrough lies, that she is trying to combine all these points of view. Not only the intersubjective boundaries are being destroyed by how Kiyanovska shapes the utterance, but also the crucial boundary between then and now. And this destruction of boundaries is what invites admiration in some readers and rejection in others. So this is the poem. It's translated by Oksana Maksimchuk. At the moment, I'm translating this very cycle into Russian. And here lies a very important question. Usually, though I teach poetry translation all the time and discuss it all the time, this topic seems to be huge and also trivial. But sometimes it's not trivial. It's the topic of rhyme. Because I suspect that for these very texts, rhyming is crucial. It fights back the idea of chaos. And though in English translation our colleagues chose to forgo for their good reasons, I think something very important disappears when you take rhyming of these very particular texts. I hold a bullet under my tongue, it tastes of plumbum, transporting me to the verge of a change as the sky gets closer. My heart feels as small as a throbbing vein beating slowly. Don't be afraid, I beg it, don't cry. You must breathe and speak, schneller, schneller, they shout, but it's hard to walk when you know this is the end. Your whole body stinks of death, the wounds that no longer bother to heal. What a miracle. I still manage to put one foot in front of the other, passing the shoeless corpses, shoes taken off by the shooters. I've gotten so used to them, I no longer avert my eyes. Sometimes I even want to take a closer look to find out why that woman, for instance, was shot in the back. Though she so wanted to love and she so loved singing, I enter a burning cloud, a wheezing fire, here is another body, now a child's. I have to lower my eyes, so small, all alone. I'd pick it up, but every minute feels like a bullet under my tongue, a tiny nail driven into the heart. I follow in the footsteps of Ezekiel, Aaron, Hur, Adam, Mitzah, Yehuda, Sarah. They're right here before me. We enter a cloud of smoke. In light of our inquiry, it is important to analyze how Kiyanovska destroys her syntax, sporadically making it incoherent. Why is she doing it? Each poem of the book abandons all rules of punctuation. Often she abandons syntactic separations. Visually, sonically, syntactically, the reader deals with seemingly unordered, chaotic flow of voices. Curiously, she often uses enjambement. The line ends abruptly, as if leaving us without opportunity to understand what comes next. And as I said, why I think that this is a rare case when in translation in any language it is rather important to mark the presence of the rhyme. The line kind of ends without development, but rhyme marks some kind of crisis. All these devices are there to create in us impression of confusion that I think is crucial for what she does. What is this confusion? How she creates it, how she works it. Kiyanovska makes her syntax often incoherent, and this is, I think, one of the most inventive and difficult uses of what Jakobson uses calls aphasia. It is often difficult to understand who is speaking here. The victim, the witness, the author. How do we, the readers, deal with not understanding of the authorial position? I argue that what is being created here, is a position of traumatic multi-voicedness, perhaps the most horrific incarnation of Bakhtinian famous principle of polyphony. Erasing, muddling her syntax, Kiyanovska shows how the very human subject can be erased. In her interview, she says, there are 302 texts altogether. It's only one-fifth that is included in this book. So when I discussed with her the process of editing, she insisted that for her one of the most decisive ways of editing was just selection of the ready product. Each text, she claims, is a combination of voices connected into some form of umbrella of one leading voice. 80 of them, she claims, belong to non-Jews. Quote, when people ask me, Kiyanovska says, what pushed me to write this, I answer, my father's sudden death. This was the first trigger, and the second trigger was when Russians invaded Ukraine. End of quote. This confused and confusing producer of the utterance seems to me to be the main operation of Kiyanovska's invention. It is also important that she writes about the past events being fully conscious about her own authorial position in the present. So not only we are lost in our attempts to figure out who is speaking, but also when is speaking. Ilya Kaminsky, another remarkable contemporary poet born in Odessa, in his recent review of this book, where he speaks a lot about one topic that I'm happy to leave for Q&A, he rather predictably and wonderfully discusses this text in light of Celan, Paul Celan writing. Kaminsky, being an American poet, is trying to kind of protect Kiyanovska from all kinds of critique about her authorial position, though I don't think she actually needs to be protected. She is remarkably brave. He writes, Babin Yar is a controversial book. It raises questions about what it means to write witness-like poetry without bearing witness to the historical events the poems are about. Something several of us in this room know things about the distinction between giving voices to victims and speaking for them. Right? Going back to the prepositions about cultural appropriations. This is the main question that Kiyanovska receives about historical projection and the right to represent another. Questions about choice of language, choice of tone. Though in agreement with Kaminsky's questions, I want to stress that Kiyanovska destroys comforts of the habitual language, normative language, in order to achieve several goals at the same time. And I think she's very successful in that. Not only she goes to reconstruct disastrous confusion of the 1941, but also she marks complexity of her authorial position, of any authorial position of somebody who tries to work with this material, completely distinct from the event of attention and yet connected to it with the author's own pain. The third poet, Alex Averbukh. This is the book. I suspect that many or some of you have seen Kiyanovska's volume. I don't think many of you have seen this volume, published by New Literary Observer recently. And I think one of the most interesting poetic phenomenon, the recent poetry, and I omit the language little badge. Averbukh writes in five languages, which makes me, as you can imagine, endlessly happy. Again, we're entering the zone of macaronic writing. And so, what is the biography? Who can this person be? Alex Averbukh, born in Luhansk, then moved to Jerusalem, where he wrote his PhD with Roman Semenchik on the 18th century poetry and drama. Now lives and studies in Toronto University. This book is called Evidence of the Fourth Person, some grammatical fourth person. The section that I will quote from today is called Vanya. Go and translate that. And overall, the question how one translates this particular kind of language, I think, is one of the most interesting questions in translation practice in general. This text describes the poet's reaction to the hybrid war between Ukraine and Russia, with lots of allusions to the poet's native town of Luhansk, and also his reactions to the conflict that is much closer to him at the moment of this book writing in terms of physical space, the ongoing conflict in Israel. So this is a poetic text of two war zones and many languages, and actually five languages that I've mentioned that he works with and plays with and breaks are Russian, Ukrainian, Yiddish, Hebrew, and German. So you have this poem on your handout. And somehow it is with the first stanza of Sasha's poem that I had a real trouble trying to translate it. You can imagine, it is difficult to fight the temptation not to use this first stanza as an epigraph to the whole conversation of the invention of the damaged language today. And it seems that I do not know Xian language. I do not know Ukrainian language. Transports the effect, but only in part. I do not know Xian language. I do not know Ukrainian language. My silence is awkward. My amnesia is total. Nothing ranges itself back as words. This small talk is falling apart. This small dance is falling apart as well. In your western land, nobody wants to hold our little hand. Nobody talks to us. Little sounds in our mouths do not become clear shrapnel-like. That gooey stuff in our mouth doesn't make its oozing sound. Give us a moment. We'll start talking. We'll talk out everything. And the river of Dnipro will sew over. As you can see now, our wound is flowing into your wound. The waterfall-like growl of words has been lost. What's been lost is the sound Xian, the sound Ukrainian. Drop of poison, like memory, is alive at the end of my tongue. In this text, two disfigured languages in their relationship of togetherness and animosity produce a scary sort of life in the poem's finale. In the original idiom, obviously, крутиться на языке means to be almost there, almost retraceable from forgetting. In Averbukh, the last drop, that very word becomes poisonous, damaged, bad. So since at the end of one's presentation, one is supposed to come up with some kind of conclusion, I think that there can be no conclusion, but a continuation of this work. But usually when in need of some kind of coda, I go to one of my favorite people who already entered this room invisibly, to Yuri Nikolaevich Tynianov, and using his question from the literary fact essay, where Tynianov thinks about the problem, what is good poetry and what is bad poetry. Tynianov writes, usually we put a sign of equation between the new things and good things. We feel good doing that. But when new things do not come, we need bad poetry of genius to make us feel all in you. So I think that what is happening here is that very плохая гениальная поэзия that Tynianov talked about. Thank you.
Well, this is a tough act to follow, to comment on poetry with any presumption of definiteness. I was struck particularly by what Professor Barskova was mentioning, that part of the confusion, that the intent of the confusion is to see if I can. The confusion of utterance. this is obviously not something that emerges only in war poetry, presumably, but somehow that seems to be a powerful stimulant. They already mentioned Pavlo Tychyna in his war poetry, because Pluch and even and Zamyshenety Oktav is poetry that deals with the revolution and the war, is characterized by a sense that we don't know where the voice is coming from. It's not a question of who the voice belongs to, but simply where is it coming from? It seems to be ambient in the air. It seems to be addressing us from many directions. The very fact that I can speak about it like this is because this talk was so stimulating and important in its focus on the actual material, on the poetry, because in order to talk about poetry, you have to hear poetry, you have to read it, and you have to be, in a sense, engrossed in it or taken in by it. And it's just as well not to have images in the background, you know, and this archaic form of looking at it on pages is valuable in itself. In any case, it occurred to me, let me put this as a question, that maybe poetry is, in its essence, antithetical to, there's a problem, you shouldn't use essence, because essence suggests essentialism and some kind of a definitive answer, but it's somehow antithetical to definitiveness, which would seem to separate out all of the traditions of, let's say, for example, neoclassical or classicist talk, or Pushkin, you know. But, you know, because what the critics say, you know, the precision, the clarity of the formulation is so striking and so engrossing and so resonant. But, of course, it also is generating nuances and shades and unanswered questions. That is to say, that this opalescence, this shimmering of meaning is maybe essential to poetry. And what these poets that Professor Barskova was discussing are rediscovering in a very unique way. This is not a question as other than whether you think that this formulation would make sense or not, to help stimulate the discussion.
There is certain direction where I think I could and I would like to take this question. As I mentioned at the very beginning, with the partly humorous inclusion of movement Roland into this conversation, if I had to demonstrate two main kinds of writing about the events of this order in poetry, I would say that there is poetry about traumatic events, there is poetry about war that is trying to reinvent comfort and reinvent order. Whatever a writer at a point of writing things to be ordered. And there is poetry that doesn't attempt to do that. And even, of course, in both anthologies, we see both approaches. And for example, this small anthology of the siege poetry, which I can mention for a number of reasons why I think it's so curiously connected to the subject at hand. For today's it is absolutely not of much interest to say that one or another approach is more or less productive. We see brilliant inventive examples of both. But I was really intrigued to see so many different ways to work with problematic language, with a bad language, and to see how differently these three poets work with seemingly kind of the same question. How history, how historical disaster destroys language and its subject. So I think that instead of the task of recreating order, these people are working with the task of creating their own versions of disorder. And also I think, speaking of kind of the research, the historical research part of this conversation, that several of them are working with the material that already exists, that they're readers' destroyers. I think this is something very productive. And that, right, there is this fanciness to this conversation about contemporary. They're scholars in their invention. And this is something that I really, really admire with other parts of this task.
Thank you. Please, we open the floor to discussion and questions. Thank you
so very much for presenting on this. I have one comment maybe and one question to you. First of all, as a comment, I'm just extremely grateful that someone like you has joined you know, our very small community in talking about this and studying this and in teaching this as well. You know, your role in publishing this anthology as well as the other anthology of Ukrainian literature is extremely important, and also kind of showing to the other people in the Slavic studies community that this is something that is very interesting, very you know, in the moment right now, extremely relevant for what is happening in the region. Mm-hmm. And so talking about the war and then studying that language, the narrative itself, and the ways to approach the experience right now, I feel is really a defining moment for the field. So I just wanted to thank you for doing that. My question is about other modes of representing war or coming to terms with war. We know, and including in this anthology, that there are examples that are almost radically opposite to that, right? So kind of to not just show this experience of a lack of continuity, of disruptiveness, etc., that the war brings, but also to kind of to shock the reader in a way into realizing what war is about. And to do that through very cohesive, almost picturesque, idyllic images that then at the end are sharply contrasted with like one phrase, like so Jadan's poem, for instance, from the collection Sun Terrace, Lots of Green, that kind of describes this idyllic relationship and then sharply goes, and then the war began and he left. Oh, and that's it. You know? So I was wondering if you could talk about that mode a little bit in terms of especially in contrasting it to the mode of decomposition, aphasia in the language, etc., as also an effective tool.
One of the tendencies, and again, like three poems, is some form of tendency. Not a commonplace, not a topos yet, but tendency that I think is connected to your question that I've noticed. And also, I rarely discuss poetry in gendered terms for a number of reasons, because I think if this needs to be done, this needs to be done bravely, subtly, and with lots of research. But I've noticed that several young women in the in this collection, and that's how I proceeded to study Yakymchuk and Afanasyeva, work with bucolic a lot. There is this text, one of my favorite, by Afanasyeva, that I usually open my courses at Hampshire, on the contemporary political situation in the region, the plum power. This abrupt breakage of the paradisiac state. I think that, again, as a device of sorts, we find in several texts. Another term that one kind of wants to use, but also very accurately, terms intimacy and everydayness, that untranslatable notion of byt. Right, and it is interesting that, again, Lutsishina, Afanasyeva, Yakymchuk are building their, you know, doll houses of poems, and then we can see how they are being destroyed. And I would say that actually that's a very interesting question, because this approach, this device, lies on the boundary between what I just outlined. Boundary between order and chaos. It's rather that momentum of change that these several people are trying to write. That's a very good idea. Thank you.
Would you want perhaps in general terms to compare some of the characteristics of poetry in the siege of Leningrad? Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Because I sat with my kitchen timer trying to tame this presentation, I didn't include one thing that I thought could be used as an epigraph of sorts to the whole conversation about this aphasia thing, which I think... it's not without its own problems. Ikapson speaks, after all, about his clinical observations, right? Not about a poetical device. So this transport of one from one field into another, it's not an obvious thing. I just can share with you the moment when I noticed that something of this kind is happening. This little book that Professor Gravovich is holding in his hands at the moment has poetries of five poets of the radical Leningrad avant-garde. These are young people who are present in some kind of a room when Harms and Vidyansky were reading. So they were trained, this is a very wrong word, but we'll use it, by the tradition of Zaun, of the second wave of Zaun, right? Non-rational poetical language. And with this training, they happened to find themselves in September of 1941 in Leningrad, when their teachers were all murdered, with the exception of Zabolotsky, who was lucky enough to get himself into camp for 10 years. They were there to describe the events of the siege. And when I began reading this in the archives with very broken language, for example, Gennady Gore constantly breaks syntax describing these events, I thought, okay, they're coming after avant-garde poetics. Simultaneously with this, I was doing my siege research in the archives, reading diaries, and suddenly I began noticing something that I began noticing disappearance of grammar. I was reading a particular diary of an art history professor who, let's say, in September of 1941, writes in this perfect Russian with perfect inclusions of French and Latin. And by December, not only he stops capitalizing, but cases disappear and prepositions disappear. And this is precisely what Gore does, also describing in his poetry this kind of, if you wish, sensation. So what interests me is this connection between aphasia as a reaction to the disaster, to trauma, and aesthetic attempt to reproduce this thing. This was this moment when in, and by the way, this professor, to make this whole conversation even more symbolic than it is, as if it needs it, is a sister of Apollinaire, who found herself in Petersburg, speaking of war poetry. Everything is connected, we just don't know how. So, taking in account this parallel aphasias, these connected aphasias, reproduce the real one, quote unquote, and the reproduced ones, when I began looking at Yakymchuk, that was the first, and several of Yakymchuk's texts work with this. And I became very interested in thinking why it's important for her, where she takes it. And also, of course, it's very seriously very interesting to think how this can be translated.
If I may interject another notion, hopefully it might stimulate further discussion, that as persuasive and as pertinent as the notion of aphasia is, and I fully accept it, it certainly speaks to the generating processes and the kind of impact that trauma has on thought and language. But there might also be, given the fact that the genealogy is there, a fundamental modernist preference or fascination for collage.
Mm-hmm.
Collage is, in a sense, de-semanticizing. It's everything. It's there. It's whether it's in Picasso or in Ticina. It is a kind of, and there have been articles written about this notion that collage is the fundamental device of modernism.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I think that maybe is pushing it, but it is a very central one. And here, you know, things are just coming in, and the element of ordering and of discriminating and of hierarchizing and of, if you will, understanding becomes secondary to
mm-hmm.
Simply the mass of experience and its traumatic core. But let's hear more. The thing is that it requires concentration. So I'm not surprised that people are reluctant. But do please ask your questions.
Can I just ask if we can circulate some of these anthologies?
Yeah.
Is it possible to have a look at some of them?
Anthologies.
Yes, what about
yes,
it?
Of course, to circulate.
I'm just wondering if we can.
Oh, yes,
absolutely.
Yeah, by the way, while doing this, let me mention another one. This also was presented at the at this ATSEAL conference.
Mm-hmm.
This is now with the editorial work of, this is called Listy z Ukrainy, and this is also Vitaly Chernetsky is involved in this, and many, and this is many more poems. This is a this is a huge, also published at the end of last year, poetic anthology, jointly with the Poles, I think. Yet let me pass all three of them around. This is opening up very new material for many of us.
And also that other anthology, the ones where we can be purchased.
Yes, and this is on sales for you all to know. Yes. Take advantage of. Other questions, please, Sahih.
Well, first of all, thanks. It's really, for me, very, very important presentation. I listened to Yakymchuk reading this mm-hmm. particular poem, and I thought, well, this is smart, this is interesting, but now I understand and appreciate much more what she was doing and what others are doing. And my first impression was that, well, we are dealing here not just with the war, but we are dealing with the breaking of a society, mm-hmm. of a world. And I had the question whether the war, where it's more clearly defined sides, would produce a different impact on the language.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know whether it's possible at all to answer that kind of a question.
Mm-hmm.
But that is one question that I have. And another one, you mentioned that you interviewed those people,
mm-hmm.
and you mentioned also, okay, that there are these links and connections between the thesis that they were writing and the particular text that they were studying. Were there any comments in sense of that the fissure and breaking language, that's something that they read in one particular text and that influenced them, or there is cross-contamination between these three authors in terms of the particular method? So did they comment at all that where this idea came from? Was it just born out of nowhere, just started to appear on the page, or there were some influences that they consciously can identify?
Both great questions. I really appreciate the first question, and this is something that I am thinking about a lot. And I don't think I'm ready to answer the question whether different kinds of war produce specifically different kinds of linguistic reaction and anesthetic reaction. And whether this kind of war with the murky.
And one part of the world that existed there turning on the other.
Right.
As opposed to the war of the worlds, yeah.
Right. Very important and I think very interesting extension of this conversation and of this talk is poetry about these events by the poets of Russian language.
Mm.
There are several of them in the anthology. Especially, as I've mentioned, and I will talk about him in a moment, at a little bit more, Khersonsky, but also Kabanov and Pomerantsev, and what they are doing. But I think our reactions of people like Stepanova and Fanailova are very connected to this problem, not that often. You can observe, you can be co-present with a poet thinking about their own culture, their own society, their own language, if you wish, at least the language of propaganda, which is endlessly interesting and endlessly disgusting, being perpetrator. This is rare to observe. Very interesting, very difficult. So, to your question about the interview process, it is remarkable how much poets resist the question of their influences.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. I find this to be somehow wonderful. Basically, if you can imagine torture by Skype, I had to do something unpleasant to Kiyanovska, that she would start talking about Ceylon. And then I found out that she translated him
mm-hmm.
and things like this. And I said, well, but Ceylon seems to be pervasive in what she does. But at first I kind of giggled and I thought, well, everybody wants to be original.
Mm-hmm.
But then I thought it's interesting, it's important that they insist not on just them being original, but their emotion, their affect being original. And when Kiyanovska says that as important as reading of Celan and Milos, this, by the way, is another figure where that many of them discuss, of people with whom I talk, and I think Milos is very important in what Kiyanovska does in connection to Milos' writing about Poland and Poles and Polish language in its relationship to the ghetto. And Kiyanovska is obviously in dialogue with this, and an interesting dialogue. But I found it to be very fresh, and it didn't come to her like this, when she says, equally important for this text is my personal loss and my experience, political experience of now. And I think this connection of several orders of trauma experience, how she weaves them, and this kind of interwoven multi-positionness of the, to what Professor Grabovich said, I really, really like that the voice is coming from everywhere. By the way, speaking of voice coming from everywhere, I think and the controversial book of Kiyanovska, I'm trying to describe one's relationship with this book. I gave her one example from Russian modernist poetry of a book that was hated equally by everybody.
And this one is...
There is lots of things that people are not always happy with Kiyanovska's book. Which,
if I can abuse, if you would be able to provide some context and bring us up to speed.
Right. Let me provide the context through the little detour. I gave her an example of blocks, 12, which I think seems to be one of the most misunderstood texts of its time. Because everybody saw Alexander Alexandrovich as agent of certain political vision, right? And they all stopped saying good morning to him, and the famous scene in the streetcar with hippies. Though I think that Bloch's text, it's much more interesting to think about it not as a political position expressed, but rather as this multi-voicedness, also a recorder of that historical moment. I think now this is one of the reasons why 100 years later, we just celebrated the centennial of the text, it reads so sharply. So back to the questions that people ask of Kiyanovska, how can you write about 1941 using the first person narrative? Most of the questions that are being asked of her are the questions of appropriation, which I think are not absurd questions. They're healthy questions to ask. I think that her way to face these questions and to stand there thinking with these questions is this extremely convoluted system of narratorial positions. And how she breaks grammar is a part of this system, to me. There is no one kind of narrative, like in Charles Reznikov's narrative poem Holocaust, for example, but many voices are trying to make their way, and Marianna is one of them. The author is Marianna, the author is one of them, and I think it's very interesting.
Yes, ask for a minute.
Thank you for taking on this really difficult work. First of all, let me just make sure I heard you right. Did you say that Young Kostrovitsky's sister was that is ironic. So whenever talking about war poetry, I know, I think of that poem as Bignor Herbert's You Must Know episode in a library, which I don't know if everybody knows that poem. It describes a poet sitting in a library and he's watching a young woman reading a poem, and she's analyzing the poem and she's scanning the poem, and he said, soon the poem will look like a salamander eaten by ants. When they carried away his body, I thought there were no more words for this. And now I see that there is, now I witness the death of words. After us, nothing will remain but silence and dust. I butchered the last stanza mm-hmm. of the poem, but that's the frame of the poem. Mm-hmm. And you know, it's an inevitable sort of response when reading work, especially from an ongoing war zone, because mm-hmm. you wonder, because you hear these cries that are coming mm-hmm. from there. You mentioned Milosz, and I was thinking of Milosz a lot throughout this talk. I was mm-hmm. thinking of Milosz, I'm saying, what is poetry that does not save nations or people? Mm-hmm. A connivance with official lies, you know, a song for drunkards, readings for sophomore girls, you know, that kind of thing that he was saying. And then I thought of Ceylon's unfulfilled wish I do not remember the exact phrasing, but he writes that poetry will only be possible when the last battleship has foundered on the last tyrant's forehead, and that, alas, has not happened. And so there is this kind of doubleness to reading this. We're reading this as poetry, we're reading this as literature, but you're also reading this as a kind of creed de coeur, a recognition of some traumatic episode that is ongoing, and you wonder what the writers long for beyond an aesthetic response. Mm-hmm. And there's also the sense that, you know, every country, every culture has by now a tragically long history of war poetry. I think of Beckett speaking about aphasia after World War II as what other response was there to that trauma? But Beckett writing, I of whom I know nothing, I know my eyes are open because of the tears that pour from them unceasingly. And so I wonder again in doing this very important work of bringing this work out into a context of where we all are, what do you imagine the poets long for? Mm-hmm. And secondly, how do you explain the kind of the way in which the waters close over these sort of traumas mm-hmm. and the language and the approach of writers generally tends to return to convention?
Mm-hmm. Great questions. One thought that came to me in connection to your wonderful suggestion question, I think that that there is something deeply and importantly political in whom Ukrainian poets choose as their interlocutors in this poetry. After all, in very aligning with Milosz and Celan and Bachmann, I think Ukrainian poetry says, I am European poetry. I am connected to you, European poetry. And also this happens in allusions, in conversations in these poems, and in this very active work of translation that is happening now. I think it's very interesting and very important that when I talk to them, they all are translating. And that becomes flesh of their poetry about these subjects. This is something that I just thought about while listening to you, about silence. And this kind of weaving back into Professor Tumarkin's question. One thing I found out about this subject while working on these two directions, that silence whatever, a theoretical construction of as very literally real literal thing seems to be a myth. Rather, what I saw, for example, from the siege, we have a logorrhea. We have so much reactions of texts of witness, testimony, production. It's unbelievable how much they wrote right there and then. And again, because to some extent, scholars, American scholars of my generation, went to the classrooms of people working with psychoanalysis, reading Kathy Caruth and so much, and the very idea that there must be silence, it's interesting that archival research breaks this assumption, that actually we see, rather than silence, this very production of bad language. And I think I find it to be hugely interesting, because it also does something with our understanding what is good and what is bad and what is poetry. This is why I ended with this notion by Tynianov, because it's a hugely complicated question, right? What is a good aesthetic response to this kind of event? Reading this kind of moves you a tiny bit, step by step, towards thinking about it. And what Averbukh does, and then the other sections of this book, which, as I said, are incredibly interesting, and I hope that we'll be able to introduce it into our teaching. I discussed it with several of you here. This is the first time that Russian and Ukrainian poetries are entering the registers of Surzhik writing. And doing amazing things with it, very complicated dialectal forms of writing, and combining different dialectal forms of writing. So again, is it good? Is it bad? This is very, I think, interesting to discuss, and trying to figure out what are their sources, what are their ways to deal, right? Because in this situation, poetic devices are also ways to deal. Also, this is what makes it so exciting and so, I think, also dangerous, because to study, because the price of triviality, of platitude, is rather high. And nevertheless, it seems that this is where the nervous zone is at the moment. Another important thing, that after some preliminary work, when poets begin talking, and I find this to be a tiny, tiny place of hope, that Ukrainian poets mention Russian poets as their influences, and vice versa. I also think that this is interesting. These dialogues are interesting. For example, Kiyanovska speaks a lot about her relationship, her literary relationship with Elena Fanailova, a journalist poet whose work, very much like Anne Carson, she undoes classical tragedy into journalistic work with the hybrid war. And Kiyanovska is translating it at the moment. So I think these conversations between poets across the borders, so to say, are extremely interesting. Going back to what Oleg suggested, this is our tiny job, to create these dialogues and to see how language can work in this places of connection.
Thank you. Any other questions?
I could just add that decades ago, must have been in the early 80s, just when Milos spoke here at Harvard, and he talked precisely about the poetry of war. And what struck me most, I don't know, remember was the word that he used about so much of the poetry was banal. And he talked about how, you know, one would think that the deprivations and the trauma of war would unlock all kinds of structures and allow people to new reaches of imagination. And instead, he saw so much falling back on, as you mentioned, convention. And especially,
I heard that lecture over there. Yeah.
Oh, yeah, yeah, you were there. Remember that? Yeah. That was really, that was Hawaii.
Mm-hmm.
Oh,
I'm
anyway, I guess the word banal struck me.
Right, because another thing that, and obviously this very moment from Luba's poem about poems beautiful as Vyshyvanka, with this ideally smooth surface. All right, if there is something that we absolutely know wars do produce, is this perfect propaganda poetry? Which is also very interesting to study, but for very different reasons. And I do have this very yellow neat file that I still need to fill in. I want to study propaganda poetry about this war, and people are informing me that indeed it exists, and there are sources and places and anthologies being published. Of that kind of reaction. So I also obviously think that it's important to look at it as well. But in difference, the very where Professor Grabovich started, the very roughness of the material that we looked at today and its resistance to the idea of maidenness, mm-hmm. if you wish. The poem, as if, as you said, collage being a process, right? The idea that collage is a happening thing. We're talking about cubism. But these are happening texts. Mm-hmm. They explode as we speak.
Ole?
I think this is a very productive, but this last I think it's very productive in kind of trying to understand what's going on there. And what I mean is the contrast to that other poetry
mm-hmm.
that is meant to build up, to support, and so on. Because it's really, in some way, about the relation to reality that the poetry is trying to establish. So this kind of poetry is really trying to be reality.
Mm-hmm.
Like not just frame it in a certain way or represent, but to directly be reality. And that's what is so sometimes shocking about it too.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why it's all disconnected and disjointed and so on. Whereas the so-called propaganda poetry,
mm-hmm.
I would rather maybe would say patriotic poetry in that regard, is trying to create, to kind of will a certain reality.
Mm-hmm.
To kind of to cut out everything that is disturbing a particular image of reality, something that is considered maybe even dangerous to that desired reality, right? And so then the image that is created is one that is supposed to lift you up, build it up, et cetera, et cetera. In that regard, of course, then it's closer to the propaganda poetry. I think also another very interesting connection could be to the music of the war periods. So so actually there is a book coming out in the same publishing house about the songs during World War II, and actually before and during and after, and what happens to them. It's by Susanne Ament, Sing to Victory. So I think that is going to be also very interesting to kind of to see how various modes of quote-unquote propaganda are utilized to create a certain reality, and then how they yield to reality.
Mm-hmm.
So they have actually the whole changes when the situation changes.
Mm-hmm.
So.
This is wonderful, and I think since this is obviously an ongoing conversation, But going back to Khersonsky, this poet who uses Jewish topics, materials, voices a lot, but remarkably differently than Kiyanovska. Another thing that he does, and this is something that really interests me, this is what Khersonsky does and what Pomerantsev does, they play with propaganda. This is poetry of kind of taking apart that tool and propaganda of various moments of Russian Empire. And I think this is also spectacular to see how they play with it. And I think it's a very interesting direction of this conversation.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
If there are any other questions? No. Thank you again for a wonderful presentation.